to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please call roll.
Monica Duran.
Here.
Zachary Taylor.
Present.
Janice Hoppe.
Present.
George Pond.
Present.
Christy Davis.
Here.
Tim Fitzgerald.
Here.
Larry Matthews.
Here.
Genevieve Wooden.
Present.
Madam Mayor, we have a quorum.
And they're in a good mood, too.
It's because you called Zach, Zach Taylor.
Any changes to the minutes of February 13 or special notes of February 13? Hearing none, those are approved as presented. I don't have any proclamations tonight, so we can move right into citizens' right to speak. If we have a speaker, that'll send my message getter hopping down there. That'll be quick. Any changes to tonight's agenda? Seeing none, let's move right into the consent agenda. Mr. Pond, would you read that for us?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Happy to present the consent agenda. Item A, Resolution 05-2017, approving action by Jefferson County Open Space to subordinate the reverter clause pertaining to the recreation center property at 4005 Kipling to permit the placement of cellular antennas. B, motion to approve the annual police radio system contract payment to the City of Lakewood in the amount of $35,519 for police radio system maintenance services. Is the motion in order?
Please give us
Madam Mayor?
Yes.
Can we pull item A and move on to B? I just have a question regarding A.
Yes, we can. We can vote on item B and then...
I move to approve item B of the consent agenda.
Second.
Seconded on that? All right, please cast your votes on that one.
Motion carries 8-0.
All right, so let's have a motion on item A and then we can have discussion. Will that work for you?
Move to approve item A.
Second.
Sorry, move to approve item A.
And discussion, would there be, is there a question then?
There is. I wanted to clarify, because it isn't clarified in here, that the $25,000, does that go back into the maintenance fund for the rec center?
Yes, it goes back to the rec center.
To be used specifically for the rec center?
For the rec center. Does not go into general fund.
Okay. Great. Thank you.
Yep.
Mr. Matthews.
I have one question, just general curiosity. Is it going to be a regular cell tower or a stealth cell tower that we talked about a couple months ago?
Fair question. Joyce can probably answer it a little better than I. We've been working on this together. You will see the lease document itself hopefully in the next couple of weeks after OSAC acts. We've seen their designs for the antenna, which will be on the roof and then a cable going down the wall. Joyce, you want to add to that?
So there are several antennas and they're screened. It isn't actually a cell tower.
Mr. Goff, were you going to add something? I thought maybe the way you were coming forward. No? Any other questions? Please? Okay. Then we already had a motion. We're in discussion. We've had a second. Please cast your votes.
Motion carries 8-0.
Okay, let's move on to item number 2, Ms. Wooden.
Thank you. This is Council Bill number 01-2017, an ordinance amending 22-56 and 22-66 of the Wheat Ridge Code of Laws to codify an increase in the city's sales tax, sales and use tax pursuant to voter approval granted on November 8, 2016. At issue at the general election held on November 8, 2016, the electorate of the city approved ballot question 2E, which increased the sales and use tax levied by the city by 0.5% to 3.5% of the purchase price. Therefore, it is necessary to amend the Code of Laws to implement this electoral decision.
Okay, I don't have to ask for an ordinance number. This is amending an ordinance, correct?
No, you'll need a second reading.
Yes.
It's second reading, it's an ordinance, you'll need a number.
Okay, then I need an ordinance number.
This will be ordinance number 1614.
Thank you. Staff presentation on this?
Well, Madam Mayor, pretty straightforward, both in the sales and use tax code sections. We have actually the percentage that that the city levies on those transactions at 3% currently. And of course, as of December 31, and that was language in the ballot measure, the tax was increased. So the sales and use tax code sections need to reflect the same number as was in the ballot question. And because it's second reading of a ordinance, public hearing required, although I've checked and no one signed up.
Want to check again?
You'll still want to open the hearing.
Are you going to check? This isn't marked for public hearing, but I'm going to go ahead.
No one signed up. Sorry, Mayor, it should be a public hearing. That box was not checked.
I'm going to go ahead and open the public hearing. Let's see, any further questions of staff, or as in this case, Mr. Dahl? No? Then I'll close the public hearing.
Motion's in order.
And ask for a motion.
Thank you. I move to approve Council Bill Number 01-2017, an ordinance amending Section 22-56 and 22-66 of the Wheat Ridge Code of Laws to codify an increase in the city's sales and use tax rate pursuant to voter approval granted on November 8, 2016 on second reading, and that it takes effect immediately upon adoption.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Urban. Any discussion? Mr. Mayor, no. Please cast your votes.
Motion carries 8-0.
Item number 3, Mr. Urban.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Council Bill 02-2017, an ordinance authorizing the issuance by the City of Wheat Ridge, Colorado, of its sales and use tax revenue bonds, Series 2017A, and providing other details in connection therewith. At issue at the regular general election held on November 8th, the electorate of the city approved ballot question 2E, which increased the sales and use tax levied by the city by 0.5% and authorized the issuance of debt to finance city investments in public infrastructure to facilitate economic development opportunities. Sales and use tax revenue bonds will be issued to finance the city's investment, which requires approval by city council. The financial impact of this is that the city of Wheat Ridge's debt will be increased by up to $33 million with a repayment cost of less than $38.5 million, and Wheat Ridge taxes will be increased up to $3,700,000 annually in the first fiscal year and by whatever amounts each year thereafter for 12 years or when $38.5 million is raised, whichever occurs first. And the bonds will be sold to an underwriter through a negotiated sales process. The bonds shall mature, bear interest from their date to maturity and be sold as all is provided in the sales certificate, provided that the aggregate principal amount of the bonds shall not exceed $33 million. The maximum total repayment cost of the bonds shall not exceed $38.5 million. The maximum annual repayment cost of the bonds shall not exceed $3.7 million, and the bonds shall not mature no later than December 1st, 2028.
Thank you. This is first reading, so please go ahead and give us a motion.
I move to approve Council Bill 02-2017, an ordinance authorizing the issuance by the City of Wheat Ridge, Colorado, of its sales and use tax revenue bonds, Series 2017A, and providing other details and connections therewith. On first reading, order it published, public hearing set from Monday, March 13th, 2017 at 7 p.m. in the City Council chambers, and that it take effect immediately upon adoption.
Second.
Seconded by Ms. Hoppe. Please cast your votes.
Motion carries 8-0.
Okay. Moving on to item number 4. Ms. Davis is going to handle that.
Motion to approve appointments to the boards and commissions. The board and commission vacancies were advertised in the Wheat Ridge Transcript, Channel 8, Wheat Ridge, city website and through other printed and electronic media type. Current members were contacted by mail and asked if they wanted to serve another term. Applications were received and compiled by the clerk's office with notification to the council on the status. If it's okay with the council, what I'd like to do is just have each district, I know that you've probably appointed someone to make your recommendations. So if you'd like to make your own recommendations, I'll start with the at-large positions, and then we'll just go through the districts 1, 2, 3, 4, if that works for you all. Is that okay?
Madam Mayor and Ms. Davis, I'm sorry to interrupt you. Before you go through the actual voting, I had been asked before the meeting to sort of weigh in on whether and to what extent members of the council could vote for appointments to boards and commissions of family members or persons that were related to them by blood or marriage. My initial reaction was, well, it's not a financial decision. Fine. I went to the charter, and the charter does say in section 5.9 that no member of the council shall vote on any question in which he has a personal or financial interest. And I gave that a little thought. And as you know, most of the time when I describe conflicts for you, it's always follow the money, because that's my bright line test. The case law also says the same thing, except where you have a spouse or a direct family member. So with that in mind, my advice is that to the extent there's a council member that is would otherwise be required to vote, because you have to vote in all cases unless you have this personal or financial interest. I think it's difficult to say you don't have a personal interest in the appointment of someone you're related to. Now, having said that, in the event such a person is appointed to a board or commission, and that board or commission makes recommendations to the council, I don't think that same council person does step down. In fact, I think that council person does vote, because the board or commission's making a recommendation, they're sending something up for you to act on. That's public business that, yes, one member of the commission is a family member, but that doesn't make it a personal or financial interest of yours. And so for that reason, I would draw the line there, and I'm sorry to have to take this time and interrupt you about it, but I've given it a thought. And if the charter is to have any meaning when it says you don't vote on something in which you have a personal interest, it's very difficult to say you don't have a personal interest in appointing a son or a daughter or a spouse to a position. I think that's one that you actually do recuse on. We have a rule that is you vote all the time. You know, some charters allow recusal for other reasons, and I think this charter is well written, because it really requires you to always vote except in that one case. I'll torture with one other example. When Mr. DiTullio was on the council, occasionally the budget for the recreation department would come up, and I, of course, his wife worked at the recreation department, but I opined that the amount of her salary was minuscule in relationship to the entire recreation center budget. If he'd been voting on an increase in that salary, sure, that's a financial interest. But you may recall several times, I think he would always ask, and we'd make a little record around whether that was a significant financial interest, and I always opine no, because it was so attenuated. Here, it's hard to escape, in my opinion, the idea that it is in fact a personal interest with no pejorative intended. It's perfectly fine for spouses and other people to serve on boards and commission and to make recommendations that the whole council then votes on. Thank you. So questions about that?
The story is that the spouses should not be, they should recuse themselves for this specific
from voting on an appointment that involves their spouse or the appointment of their spouse. They can certainly vote for a family member. They can certainly vote for other appointees to that commission, you know, like any others. And I assume you'll take motions individually,
okay,
so you'll be able to separate that out.
Separate it out.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So I think I'll start, and I think I'll start off with the right process here, with the at-large members. I will start with two at-large members that I'll be nominating, and it won't require a council member to recuse themselves. I move to appoint Michael Griffith, at-large member, to the Board of Adjustments, term to expire 3/2/20. I move to also approve Larry Richmond to the Board of Adjustments Commission, term to expire as well 3/20. 3/2/20. So those are the two I'll do for now.
Second.
Second from Mr. Pond. And please go ahead then and cast your votes.
Motion carries 8-0.
Okay, and then my last at-large member motion I'd like to make is I move to appoint Nathan Hoppe to the Building Code Advisory Board.
Second.
Term to expire 3/2/20.
I will be recusing myself from this vote due to a personal interest conflict.
Thank you. Did you get the second, Ms. Duran?
Duran.
So, we got a second here, and please go ahead and cast your votes.
Motion. Can she abstain?
Yeah, she.
Yes.
The one time you can use the yellow button.
I didn't see the yellow. Motion carries 7-1 with Councilmember Hoppe abstaining.
Okay, so we can move on to District Number 1.
That's funny.
And are you handling that, Ms.
Yep.
Duran? Thank you.
I move to appoint Diane Robb to the Cultural Commission, term ending 3/2/20. Cynthia Hernandez-Sanchez to the Building Code Advisory Board, term ending 3/2/20. Second.
Seconded by Ms. Hoppe. Please cast your votes.
Let's try that. Please vote again. Motion carries 8-0.
Thank you. And District 2.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. We had, you know, the good news is we have a lot of people coming back to our as incumbents, and we also had several applicants for a couple applicants for one position. So I, over the weekend, talked with the planning, it's for the Planning Commission, so I talked with the chair of that and got some questions, because I think that the applicants, it's difficult because the applications are so brief that it's hard to kind of make a decision based off of the two questions that are on the application. So I was given three questions by Mr. Ohm, and then I just asked a couple questions based off of the questionnaire. I did ask both applicants for the Planning Commission, and I just wanted to go through that was the process based off of this motion. And really, truly, all of our applicants are very committed, and so I just want to thank all of our applicants, both those that we accepted positions for the incumbent position, and then also in the areas where we had multiple applicants. They're all very committed, great people in our community. So I just wanted to explain that a little bit. So with that, I'll go through the motions. So I move to appoint Ms. Lily Griego to the Board of Adjustments, term expiring 3/2/20. I move to appoint Ms. Millie Nadler to the Cultural Commission Board and Commission, term to expire 3/2/20. I move to appoint Ms. Patricia Ennis to the Parks and Recreation Commission, 3/2/20. And I move to appoint Mr. Chad Haar to the Planning Commission. And again, the only decision for that was based off of experience, and he just had more experience at the time. And that is to the Planning Commission, term to expire 3/2/20.
Madam Mayor?
Yes.
I'd like to ask for the Planning Commission appointment to be made separately from the other appointments.
Okay.
All right, you
so
want me to reread it?
Please read the three that once again.
Okay, so I move to appoint Lily Griego to the Board of Adjustments, term expiring 3/2/20.
I move to appoint Ms. Millie Nadler to the Cultural Commission board to expire appointment 3/20, 3/2/20. And I move to appoint Ms. Patricia Ennis to the Parks and Recreation Commission board to expire 3/2/20.
Second.
Second on that from Mr. Urban. Please cast your votes.
Motion carries 8-0.
And then the second appointment is I move to appoint Mr. Chad Haar to the Planning Commission, term to expire 3/2/20.
I'll ask for a second on that and then discussion. Can I have a second on that?
Second.
Seconded by Ms. Wooden. And now discussion.
My main concern relative to this specific appointment is, and this may be a question for the clerk, as it relates to the applicants and when those applications were received and whether or not the application for this particular appointment was received before or after the deadline that was advertised.
Well, Mr. Haar's application was received after the deadline that was published. He came in and about three, well, let's see, the deadline was on a Thursday, and he came in the following week, and the deputy told him that the deadline was over, and I overheard the conversation. I came out, and he said, well, someone just called him and told him to come in and apply. So we took the application. But yes, it was after the deadline.
Okay, thank you.
So I guess another question is, my understanding is there were several applications that came in after the deadline, is that correct?
There were.
Madam Mayor.
Yeah, Mr.
There were, I think, three that came in after the deadline.
Clarify, when was the deadline?
That first Thursday in February, was it the 2nd?
February 2nd.
February 2nd.
And I have here that Mr. Haar applied on February 6th, is what I'm showing?
Correct.
Okay. My only concern is, why do we have a deadline if we're not going to follow a deadline? If applicants put their application in before that deadline, got it in on time, that should be honored. I mean, to dismiss it and say, well, you know, we asked you to, but you didn't, we're still going to take a look at someone who applied afterwards. So I would go with the applicant that did apply on time, is how I feel. If we're not going to follow those rules, then why do we have them?
So can I add to that real quick? I'd like to just add to that, because I do think that it is a process that we can look at, but I can say that in the past we've not held that deadline fast and hard. I know that even last year, Mr. Urban and I encouraged a couple folks in our district to apply to another position, and they did apply past the deadline. So I think that's fine if that was a process that was always kept, but it's not been one that's, I think it's been like a goal of that deadline, of how it's been used in the past. So I guess if that is a process that we're going to put in place, then we shouldn't have submitted the other applications, and it's not a process that we've had previously. We have gone past deadlines and taken applications. So I think that if that's something we do, I think we need to go forward and look at that process and correct it, because it is a process that we have been not fast and hard on the deadline.
Mr. Matthews.
At one of our previous meetings, we discussed the idea of procedures and whether or not they should be followed. And in this particular case, it was over our contributions to the words escaping me, the
outside
agencies. And, you know, we went through a process where monies were given to outside agencies, and another outside agency came out to us afterwards asking for money, and we said we have procedures, we need to follow them, otherwise we have anarchy. And I just am fully in favor of standing by those procedures. We set a deadline, the deadline was not met, and it's my belief that all applicants that filed on or before the deadline need to be given first consideration. And then after all voting and slots from those, that pool of applicants is completed, if we wish, because we would be assigning people anyway, we need to make, would need to make the decision then, do we want to re-advertise so that everyone is on the same page for any remaining open slots, or choose from the ones that applied late and to fill any remaining slots? And that's my feeling on it. We need to follow procedure.
Mr. Fitzgerald.
I'd like to ask the clerk, you said three other applications came in after the deadline. Are all of those three, or any of those three, being considered on our spreadsheet here?
I think there were three altogether.
But they're on the spreadsheet.
Chad Haar and Karen Berry, and it should be on the spreadsheet there. Does it say?
It doesn't say, as far as I can see.
The date?
No. Oh, yes, it does. No letter mail.
I think it does.
It was just on the reapplied date, not on the...
Yeah, just on the reapplied.
It just has on the reapplied date, not on the other dates. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What was the other one?
There's a date that they show that if they reapplied, but not the other dates.
So I'm understanding, though, that those other applications are on our spreadsheet and are being considered.
They are. They're on the list. Yeah. Oh, if you're asking, are all of the people who submitted late applications on your list? Yes, they are.
Madam Mayor.
Mr.
What I wanted to state was, I think if we intend to change and remove the deadline, if we want to have that discussion and do that in the future, I'm willing to have that discussion. But I think to change the rules tonight, with nobody understanding that there was no deadline, we're now going to accept after deadline applications, I don't think it's fair. So I think it's fair to appoint the ones that applied on time, and then if we want to change the rules for next time or change it permanently, we can have that discussion at a study session.
Yeah, I need to add to that. Mr. Pond hasn't said it.
I do understand and appreciate the logic that Ms. Tran and Mr. Matthews are putting forward. I will say, and I think this is where it gets sticky, is that our policy has been to accept these after a published deadline. Published deadline, which is not coming out of a charter or code of laws, but a need to get them in by a certain date to process them. Not that that's not significant, I get that it is. But in truth, our process to date has been to allow applications to come online sometimes, I mean, for various reasons, frankly. I mean, to be honest, for various reasons. Sometimes because we had to and needed to make sure that we had applications come in for these positions. So the truth is that it has not been a hard and fast policy, and that's the way it's been, that's just the way it's been handled to date. So it would be a change, actually, either, you know, for us to say, strictly speaking, it's the cutoff and that is it, because in fact in years past we haven't done that. So
I need to. Mm-hmm. Okay.
As it relates to those specific reasons why we may have considered an applicant past the deadline in previous iterations of this process, my assertion would be in those instances we pursued that opportunity in the event of a vacancy where there had been no applications made for that specific application. We hadn't gone out and got more applicants.
Yes, we did.
Well,
I can give you the example.
Okay. My concern here is on this applicant. We have an applicant who applied on time, and there were many applicants who applied before the deadline. So, in fact, one of the applicants is stated in her email to the clerk relative to her application acknowledging that she had missed the deadline. So that, to me, is an acknowledgement and understanding that there was a deadline and people were trying to meet that. And we have to at least consider those that applied to begin with under the deadline, and then Should there be any remaining vacancies after that, then we can consider those who applied after the deadline. And, you know, frankly, it isn't to the merits of the individual. You know, Frederick Law Olmsted could come in and apply for the Planning Commission, and if he applied after the deadline, I would still have concerns. He's also dead and doesn't live in Wheat Ridge. But the fact is that I'm concerned about the precedent that we're setting to consider applicants after the deadline. And for that, I would like to make an amendment to the motion to insert Vivian Voss for the name of Chad Haar.
I'll second that motion.
Madam Mayor.
Let's continue this discussion here. Yeah, that's right. Once the motion's made, we have to do something with it.
I think there's some discussion.
Let's have some discussion on that motion and that second. You'd want to discuss that?
As to the argument that this is what we've done in the past, I find it very hard to abide by the concept, well, we've been doing it wrong for so long, let's just keep doing it wrong. If we've realized that we're not following procedure, then the time to change is immediately and follow procedure until we decide to actually officially change procedure.
And Mr. Fitzgerald?
When we talk about logic and consistency, I think it's valid to talk about the fact that we enforce the policy on another occasion. That seems like a very compelling argument. On the other hand, even tonight we're being inconsistent because we've already voted on two other people, or we will vote on two other people that did the same thing, that is to say, apply late. So what you're essentially doing here is singling out one person, one office, to not be considered because they did not meet the deadline, where at the very same time, we may consider two other people who did the very same thing.
Madam Mayor.
I've got a motion for, are you still discussing this one?
Yes. Janelle, can you clarify, did we just appoint people this evening that applied after the deadline?
Oh. The ones for District 1, they were in on time. Lily Griego and Millie Nadler were on time. And Patricia
Ennis. She was on time.
She was on time. She applied on 118, I
yeah,
show here.
She's
okay.
On time.
Yeah.
Okay. 117.
They've all been on time.
Okay, I wanted to clarify that. Secondly, if you've kind of waived the rules before, I wasn't aware of it, and if that was standard procedure, something you guys did, then I should have been informed, just as Councilman Matthews should have been, Hoppy. I wasn't aware that at times you had changed the rules. I was going by the rule of you apply by February 2nd. If you don't, then it's too late. So, you know, I can't support not appointing somebody who did the work, put their time and effort in, and applied, and they want to volunteer their time.
All right, I have a first and a second. I've had discussion. Let's go ahead, and I want to vote on this amendment, which was to do you want to repeat it again for me?
I think it was pretty clear.
Well,
I made Ms. Voss for... He was nominating Ms. Voss for the planning.
Nominating Ms. Voss. I just wanted to make sure that everybody knew, you know, basically what page we're on. So could you please, Mr. Pond, we're still in discussion.
Just for clarification, this is a motion to replace the name of Chad Haar with Vivian Voss.
Correct.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Okay.
I'm gonna go ahead and vote yes on this amendment. I want to make sure that we're kind of putting this up. At least that's my feeling, that we'll have a discussion on the candidate. I will come back to this. I regardless of where we're at, and I know that some people feel off, off kilter on how we've handled it or not handled it. When we come around, however we come around on this, I am going to state that I think our rule should be flexible. And so I want to try to get to a reasonable solution for everyone here and try to strike some compromise and not create any contention in this. But I will tell you afterward that I am going to suggest, in fact, that we have a flexible you know, deadline, and that we're actually codifying the practice that we've already been doing.
Madam Mayor.
Mr. Urban.
Thank you. The concern I have is both in relationship to the hard and fast deadline and the desire to be flexible, but then that same application of flexibility and understanding of policies and procedures isn't necessarily spread equally across the board. And I think Mr. Matthews pointed out correctly relative to the discussion regarding the Seniors Resource Center and how it was very apparent in the last council meeting that we sort of hung the process up on the cross and sort of worship the process as it relates to the outside agency committee process. But here we're talking about a separate process and we're desiring to be flexible. And my initial reaction to this was such that we should consider the applicants who have come in on time and at the time when we have remaining vacancies after all of the on-time applicants have been considered, then we can consider those whose applications came in late or incomplete. And so that would be my concern for being consistent, not just in within this particular matter regarding the boards and commissions applications, but across our implementation of the of processes, that I think there is a need and a desire to be flexible with individuals who are willing to serve our community. And I appreciate the time and effort that those who applied late took to apply. However, I have to respect those who applied on time and consider those applications first before I consider those who came in late.
I'd like to just add to that since it's our district. I do think that previously, and I'll share, and I think I did an email with you, Mr. Urban, of an example that we used last year, that we did have an applicant and we took late applicants last year. So I don't think we were setting a precedent. I also do think we need to be flexible on the timelines because these are people, our community volunteering. It's not a statute of you're being elected and this report has to be turned in by this time and this report has to be turned in by this time. So it is a volunteer position and any and all volunteers selected or not selected should be appreciated. And in my opinion, a lot of the purpose of my decision making was based not about, you know, who crossed the finish line first, but also experience. And I did take the time to talk with the Planning Commission chair to check with them on some of their needs and what they see in the future. And I did also take the time, of which Mr. Urban, I did email you and call you this weekend about, and interview both of those applicants to try to make a fair an impartial decision on a knowledge base, as as the chair of the Planning Commission has commented that it's an important time for Wheat Ridge right now regarding codes and zoning and that type of thing. So I did base my decision not on commitment, because I think both of them are committed. If one of them turned in an application 3 days later, it was what it was. But based off of experience, and I think that is my role as a council person, is to appoint also the most experienced person, especially when it's in a situation where in the past the appointment date, either right or wrong, has not been a fast, hard date.
I'm gonna have to call this to I'd like to have this. We can't be sitting here all night bickering over this.
Motion to amend.
Yes. I
wouldn't call this bickering, ma'am.
Okay.
It's a discussion.
It's a discussion. All right. Thank you. Mr. Matthews.
I wonder if maybe while we're considering this, maybe we should enlarge this conversation and say that when people apply to become council members, we set a deadline. Maybe we should start taking applications after the deadline for general elections.
Any other discussion on this? Please cast your votes. Then.
So what are we voting?
You're voting whether to
replace Zach's.
This is the motion to amend.
Okay.
Replacing the, yes.
Okay.
Motion carries 6-2 with council members Fitzgerald and Davis voting no.
Okay.
So now, Madam Mayor, we have a main motion amended to appoint Vivian Voss to the Planning Commission.
Second.
Doesn't need a second.
Okay, so that, who was the first and second?
Don't need a second.
It's the original motion.
The original motion as amended.
Yes.
So, there's a lot going on here, sorry.
The original motion was made by Councilmember Davis and seconded by Councilmember Wooden.
On the original motion, you're right, I'm sorry.
But it's been amended since.
Since that is if there is a discussion available, and I need to say something here. I think it is very wrong to change the method basically in the middle of this appointment period. These applicants we've had before where applicants have come in late. These applicants knew that there was not that
point of order.
They did.
Are we open for discussion here?
I'm allowed to discuss it. This is we have a first and a second. I'm allowed to do discussion. Okay. So what I'm saying is I think we're handling this very poorly, in the sense that we had set up that the process was loose. Has been loose right along. And now in the middle of this particular boards and commission appointment time, we're suddenly putting in strong rules one way or the other. And I think we should wait till after this particular appointment time and go ahead and embrace some of the rules that have been suggested. Ms. Hoppe.
I can say that in practice, Ms. Duran and I in the past, the last time we had the opportunity to appoint people to boards and commissions, we specifically looked at if somebody came in on time or not on time, and that absolutely led our discussions and whether that person would then be considered. And if it were a position where no one else had applied and they came in late, then that's when the consideration came, when we had that discussion. As a point, I think that we're all arguing both sides of the coin here. The reality is, yes, in practice, we haven't been necessarily following the letter of the law, but then now that we should be following the letter of the law, the reality is it's all about how everybody's translating what the process should be, and there's not anything that's set in stone. So for me, that is the way that Monica and I have been looking at our appointments in the past. Those are the discussions that we've had in the past. And so, unfortunately, I think that we're caught in a place where, when in doubt, go with procedure.
Ms. Wooden?
This isn't necessarily about the deadline, but I do have a comment about the process and the procedures that we're talking about. We're in a great position in some ways right now where we have more people applying than positions, and we haven't always been in that state. And so it's a great thing to have many people applying, and I think we need to sit at a study session and talk about procedures as to what are we going to do. We do have some members on boards and commissions who have held their positions for many, many years and served the city in a wonderful way for many years. However, we do encourage other citizens to participate and then to serve on boards and commissions. So, you know, we don't have term limits for boards and commissions, and how are we going to negotiate that? So I think something needs to be discussed at study session regarding boards and commissions appointments, how long they're going to be, if there is a vacancy and that person wants to continue serving, do we then make the adjustment, let them continue serving even though there was? Because many times a year ago, we were begging for people on boards and commissions, and now we have 4 or 5 people applying for one position. So I think this is definitely not only procedurally, but for term limits, a discussion for the next round for boards and commissions at a study session.
Any other?
I was just going to say, I agree with having a discussion at a study session and kind of establishing some ground rules. If the ground rules have been flexible, I have to say I was unaware of it. And I've been on here a year. It was never shared with myself. And Councillor Hoppe and myself have gone by the deadlines. So we followed the rules that we thought were in place and that we should follow, same as the applicants followed the rules in applying before a deadline.
Anyone else? Mr. Pond?
Again, I'm just gonna project that I appreciate all the discussion. I very much appreciate the work that Councilman Davis did to, I think, methodically look at the situation. And in some way, reluctantly, I'm going to kind of go towards trying to honor what seems to be, you know, the understood procedure and to an extent what Ms. Hoppe and Ms. Duran just outlined. I again will reiterate that I think that we have to readjust this and create a pathway that allows us to really look at it in a different way. And I agree very much with Ms. Wooden's comments about limiting terms and doing some other things. So I think we should capture all of that within this. You know, I'm not sure, you know, in this case, perhaps because of not being clear on some of the procedures, we may not be getting, in fact, the most, you know, the person who fits the criteria in terms of some of the background and knowledge to bring onto the commission, but in fact did go through the procedures in that way. So that's where I'm going to be.
If there's no further discussion, we can go ahead with the vote. This was the vote to appoint Ms.
Can you reread the vote? I mean, yeah, restate the vote.
The vote was to appoint Ms.
Vivian Voss.
Vivian Voss, yeah, to the Planning Commission.
Motion carries 7-1 with Councilmember Davis voting no.
Let's move on then to, where are we here? District 3.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. I move to appoint Jareth Gronsky to the Cultural Commission, term ending 3-2-20. Tom Abbott to the Board of Adjustment, term ending 3-2-20. And Kathy Konitz to the Parks and Recreation Commission, term ending 3-2-20.
Do you have a second?
Second.
Do we have discussion on this one? Please cast your, Mr. Matthews.
Just to be clear, did all three applicants, since we're applying these back to everybody, have you verified that all three applicants applied on time?
Did the clerk do that?
I think so. I think they were.
Please cast your votes.
Motion carries 8-0.
And District 4?
We have 5 appointments. I'm going to read one by itself and then the other 4 together. And the first one is for the Cultural Commission. I move to appoint Carol Matthews to the Cultural Commission, term ending 3-2-20.
Second.
You're going to recuse yourself. Do you want to make that announcement?
Make it stop.
Yes, I will abstain or recuse myself from this particular vote. That is my wife.
Thank you. Yeah. Please go ahead and cast your votes.
Oh, I didn't move the button. Vote again.
Vote again.
Motion carries 7-1 with Councilmember Matthews abstaining.
Okay, now I'm going to read the next 4 together. I move to appoint Donna Kimsey to the Planning Commission, term ending 3-2-20. I move to appoint Liz Veder to the Parks and Recreation Commission, term ending 3-2-20. I move to appoint Christine Taraskowitz to the Parks and Recreation Commission, term ending 3/2/20, and I move to appoint Paul Hovland to the Board of Adjustment, term ending 3/2/20.
Second.
No discussion. Please cast your votes.
Motion carries 8-0.
Thank you. That ends that group, that vote. And let me say congratulations to all who are appointed. Thank you for being good citizens who are helping us on boards and commissions. You're a very important part of the operation of the city. So you're very appreciated. And now we'll move on to the last item before we get on to study session. We have our guests ready there for us already. Who is reading?
Me.
Mr. Fitzgerald, yes.
Okay. This is a bid, a motion rather. Motion to ratify mayoral reappointment of Thomas Abbott to the Housing Authority, representing District 3, term to expire March 2nd, 2022. At issue, the members of the Housing Authority are appointed by the mayor and ratified by City Council. Thomas Abbott has served as a District 3 representative on the Housing Authority since July of 2013. His appointment was to fill a vacant seat so the Housing Authority could continue to conduct business. The seat is set to expire March 2nd, 2017. Mr. Abbott has reapplied to the seat he currently holds, and there are no other applicants.
Second.
We have a second on it? Please give us the motion.
Okay, the motion. I move that Thomas Abbott be reappointed to the Housing Authority from District 3, term to end March 2nd, 2022.
Second.
Well, there's four of them. Four of them did second. I think the loudest might have been
okay.
Duran. Let me say that I did check and to find out that Mr. Abbott has done an excellent job. He attends every meeting and is appreciated. His experience is valuable, and I think he will continue to serve well. Please go ahead and cast your votes.
Motion carries 8-0.
Madam Mayor, may I ask a procedural question?
Sure.
Does the clerk's office notify the folks that have been appointed to the board and have not?
Both.
Okay.
We send a nice, thank you for applying letter to the people that aren't appointed, and we send a congratulatory letter to the people that are, and then they come in and take their oath, and they get a pretty certificate. Yep, we do both.
Okay, we're toward the end of the meeting here, but I do need city manager's matters.
Yeah, thank you, Mayor. Just a quick update. Good news. We just were notified that the city's received another grant for the Wadsworth project. It's the Federal Highway Safety Improvement Program grant, $2.6 million. City has to match that with $260,000, a 10% match. And so that'll help us. There's still a little bit of gap, and we don't know what the final budget is yet still, but that's going to help us a long ways. Unfortunately, we told you a while back we received a grant for a new street sweeper also, mm-hmm. But it has to go through a federal Buy America waiver process. And unfortunately, it's a federal process, so who knows when we'll get our street sweeper. It could be as late as the end of the year, so we still have the grant, hopefully, but there's a long process to get that approved. Thanks.
City attorney's matters?
Could I just ask?
You bet.
Patrick, a quick question. On the Wadsworth issue, when do you anticipate that this council will start seeing some design criteria and just preliminary designs and things that will start getting that process in motion to kind of review?
Yeah, it's still in the EA process. Let me see if we have it scheduled. I think we have a public meeting. Let me see. Hold on one second. Thought we had it scheduled for an upcoming meeting. I don't see anything through May. A quick update on that. It's still in the EA process, and we were hoping it was going to be done soon by this summer, but unfortunately there was the state, CDOT, has a new employee who works in the historical properties division, and this new person has identified potentially three new properties along the corridor that potentially could be of historic nature. So unfortunately, it could delay the process by up to 18 months.
My condolences.
Yeah. So I'm sorry, I don't have a specific date right now, but that is going to delay it potentially. I'm not sure how long. So,
and then I assume that, I mean, our whole construction schedule, everything's going to go wacky.
Yeah, right now I think staff has told me for sure it's gonna delay the EA finalization for at least 6 months, and I think we were hoping to have that done by the end of the summer, so it could extend that by another 6 months.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yep.
Mr. DeTullio, you had something you wanted to say?
Yes, I just wanted to let council know, but the next couple of days we'll have the financial report out for December, and we're still auditing those numbers. So for December of 2016, we'll have that information on the website, and I'll email you the information. Then we're also going to have a new financial report for the Fruitdale School project, and you'll see that revenues and expenses of that project since they began construction. And then the last thing I wanted to kind of give you some food for thought is that in the past, the deadline for boards and commissions has been an issue, pro and con. It's been waived sometimes, like Ms. Davis had mentioned. And what we used to do a long time ago was that the deadline for the boards and commissions application was the night of the meeting. So actually somebody could come in and turn their application in that night. Then if somebody's working or out of town or they miss a deadline, then they can be considered that night, and they can speak and say why they want to be on the board or commission. But I would recommend you eliminate a hard deadline and just make it the night of the meeting you're going to make the appointments, and that eliminates a lot of issues. Just a suggestion.
Thank you. City Clerk?
I just want to, excuse me, I wanted to inform the council that the Liquor Authority has scheduled a show cause hearing for the establishment known as Big Willie's out on West 44th Avenue to consider liquor license violations and other improprieties related to that license. The hearing is scheduled for Thursday, March 9th at 9 a.m. in council chambers. And if the council members have any questions about it, they can certainly contact me or talk to the deputy clerk, Robin Eaton.
City council members, would you like to, I know you had a senior gathering.
I did. I wanted to thank all the great speakers I had on Saturday the 25th at the Senior Resource Center. I wanted to thank their time. They took the time to come in and sharing their knowledge and experience, and thank the citizens that attended. There was a lot of information that's still sinking in, but I appreciate it. So it was a good turnout, and it was great. Thank you.
Thanks for having that. Ms. Hoppe?
Nothing tonight. Thank you.
Mr. Urban?
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Tomorrow afternoon at 4 p.m. in the conference lobby room, I'll be meeting with Congressman Ed Perlmutter's Youth Advisory Council, which is made up of about 10 students from both Jefferson and Adams County. And that particular Youth Advisory Council has some questions regarding housing and homelessness, so we'll be discussing that tomorrow at 4 o'clock. And just wanted to give everybody information on that. Thank you.
Mr. Pond.
Nothing tonight. Thank you.
Ms. Davis.
Nothing. Thanks.
I'd like to announced that Councilman Pond and I will be holding a District 3 meeting on the 18th of March at the Rec Center at 9:30 a.m. All District 3 residents are invited, as is anyone else who cares to come. Thank you.
Did you say 8?
9:30.
Not tonight, thank you.
Nothing.
I usually have coffee with the mayor the first Saturday of the month, but because of our retreat, that won't be this Saturday. It'll be the next in April. We'll do that again, but I'll also put in out a Facebook thing about that. I think that ends the meeting. We're going to have a wonderful presentation tonight on glass recycling, and we have two special guests, both Brittany Evans, who is the president of Clear Intentions, as well as in the back of the room we have Bill Dilliman, who is the plant manager at Rocky Mountain Bottling. And so Rocky Mountain Bottling is a user of what is recycled glass.
Madam Mayor?
Yes?
I need to change the recording.
Okay, that'll be fine. And this is not, you know, I've talked about putting together.
She's got to change the recording.
I know. Oh, I guess, yeah, I was just explaining, but you're right.
All your important stuff.
Yeah, we'll just forget it. It was so important. We're going to take a stretch break. Quick. This is not brought on by the citizens group that I hope to bring together as a mayor's sustainability kind of a ad hoc committee, but an interesting timing. So please go forward.
Wonderful. Well, hello everybody, and thank you for having me here. My name is Brittany Evans, and I am the president and founder of Clear Intentions. Clear Intentions is located here in Denver, Colorado, and what we do is we process glass. That is the core of my company. And what this means is that we actually gear to divert glass from landfills back into our economy. Now, a big part of this is also offering services to collect glass, because there are a lot of problems in collecting glass, which I will get into and explain a little further. And some exciting things that we do is we do work with municipalities to set up a few different options for glass recycling, and we do glass only, so what is called source separated glass recycling. And then we take it to the warehouse in Denver, Colorado, and we turn it into what is called cullet. And then, as you can see, it gets turned back into bottles. That is the biggest industry for glass recycling. And we are lucky here to have Rocky Mountain Bottling Company in Denver, or in Colorado, who needs a lot of this glass to turn back into new bottles. So it's a perfect closed loop system, a very exciting thing to be a part of, both as a company who is helping to make a closed loop system for Colorado, but also for the participants who really do want to see, the public who wants to see true sustainable efforts and their city is going to zero waste goals and succeeding. So a couple of things that are a lot of fun to explain a little more of the glass recycling industry, apart from bottles, because everybody knows about the bottle industry, which is great. But there's a couple of other end markets and products here in Colorado that I also like to touch base on. They're not nearly as big, but they are all local, and they are all in need of glass as well. And a couple of them are things that are used for water bottles and glasses. You might have seen at restaurants where it's wine bottles that are cut off. A few other things are terrazzo, where they're using colored glass and putting it into countertops and tiles, art pieces, sand, fireplaces you might see. And then the last is the sandblasting media and abrasives. So this is in your construction. And the neat thing about this is that glass is what's called inert. So when people are using abrasives, it's one of the only abrasives that they can actually use around water and not be concerned about what is going back into the waterways. So it's a very sustainable option to use for the construction industry. Now, a couple of things about the glass recycling industry, which is very interesting to note, because there's all these industries who do want the recycled glass, but the biggest question is, why is it not happening? And what are the real facts about it? A couple of top facts that I brought out for you guys today is that glass is infinitely recyclable. This is my favorite fact of them all, because what this means is that glass is what's called a truly closed loop material. We can recycle it infinitely without any loss in quality. This is particularly unique to glass. Unlike any other packaging material we use, it is the only one that can do that and have a true closed loop system. The second fact is it takes 40% less energy to recycle glass than to mine for new material. And so you actually start to see a lot of savings, not only in manufacturing, but in mining for the materials. So you have the mining to the materials, the melting down of the material, and the making of the product. While in recycling, you see that we can take the material from the economy that's already mined from the earth, we can melt it down and it uses less energy, it doesn't have the same emissions, and it has the same quality that it would if we were using new material, which is very unique. The third, and that restarted my numbering, I apologize. So the third is the glass recycling rate in Colorado. This is a number I actually did receive pretty recently, but right now our recycling rate in Colorado is extremely low, and especially for the glass industry, and that is one out of every 100 bottles are being recycled here in Colorado, which is devastating, because we have a very sustainable culture here, and people want to do the right thing. The next thing is that we have about 13,000 tons, or in pounds, 26 million pounds of glass being discarded every month in Colorado. So when you put those two facts together, only one out of 100 bottles is being recycled, you start to see how big this problem really is. We have a lot of glass going into our landfills in Colorado, and we have so much opportunity to actually utilize that resource back into the marketplace. And the last one is that the main use for recycled glass, as of right now, is used for landfill cover. And this is shocking for a lot of people, because the glass that's being put into our recycling streams is not going back into the economy the way that we would want it to, the way we see recycling in our perceptions of what recycling should be, where it goes back into the economy. It's unfortunately still ending up in the landfill as landfill cover. So the big question to this is why? What is happening? So this brings up the two recycling systems that are available. One is single stream, which is very commonly known, and the other is source separated. Single stream, you know, is considered convenient, that is the perception, and you put all of your materials into one bin. Source separated means you take that material out and you do something where it says glass only. Glass is only allowed in this bin, and that is it. Now, single stream, even though its perception is convenient, it's also less efficient. So something I actually marked out for you here is the process and flow through the industry. So you go from collecting the material in single stream from a client, and then the trucks optimize their loads by compacting those loads and bringing it to a MRF, which is a material recycling facility. Now, the trucks are great in the fact that they need to optimize their loads to be efficient. However, when they optimize and compact, you can imagine what happens to glass. It shatters, and then it gets embedded in all of the other materials. So that's not really good for the other materials, nor is it good for glass. So when they take it to the material recycling facility, when they are trying to separate out these materials, what ends up happening is the glass is pulling out about 25% of the other materials, and it is so contaminated that it is extremely difficult for any processor in the world, I will state that, in the world, not just our nation, to separate them, to separate the glass out from all of that contaminated material. It takes a lot of money, it's extremely expensive, and your rate of success is very low comparative to a source-separated stream. Now, after they do separate it, they would sell it to a processor like myself. And we're the ones who are supposed to clean it up and turn it back into a supply for the economy to use if we can utilize it. And then we sell it back to a manufacturer who makes a product out of it. Now, the quality of this material is very low, and you lose a lot of material in this, as I had just mentioned. So you're losing about 50% or higher of glass. Most of your glass is still ending up in the landfill, with maybe 30 to 50% being saved back into manufacturing. That is an extremely low rate. And most processors who are dealing with single stream are not even seeing a 50% success rate. They're seeing 30% as good. The next thing is the factor of three for other materials. What this means is that for every pound of glass in our single stream, it is actually taking out 3 pounds of other materials with it in contamination that other recyclers and processors cannot use. So this is your paper, your aluminum, your cardboard. It's really hurting the recycling rates all around. The last thing about this is that it's extremely expensive. Transporting glass around is expensive itself. It's the one material that you have to have locally recycled. We have 90% of our recyclables going to China. We can't do that with glass. It is too heavy. But because of that, we have local processors, and that's why I say we are very lucky to be here in Colorado with manufacturers who can take it and can recycle it and utilize it the right way. And what this does is this is extremely expensive for trucks and MRF equipment. And why I say this is because the single stream is meant for all materials, not just glass. Glass is extremely abrasive. It's also very heavy. So it does ruin trucks very quickly and brand new MRF equipment within months. You go to any MRF facility, they will tell you the same thing. They do not like glass. They don't like touching it. They wish it weren't in their stream because it hurts their material, or it hurts their material and the machinery, and it becomes a very expensive material for them to save. If you compare that to source separation, it is more efficient. As I have the process laid out for you, the two things that do get cut out in a source-separated system is it goes directly from a client to a glass processor here. So you're actually skipping the step of the MRF and a glass MRF, which you would have to do here. So in order to separate out glass from all the contaminants, you would send it to a material recycling facility who would then send it to another material recycling facility that is specialty, its specialty would be glass, excuse me. And so they would separate it out even further and try to decontaminate it and process it into an actual good supply for manufacturers. So you all of a sudden shrink that supply chain and make it a lot more efficient for people and manufacturers to get it back into the economy, making it more economically feasible for our entire economy to afford glass recycling as well as the glass material. And then on top of it, you have high quality. So you have a higher quality and you don't lose any material. It's been a long time since some of the biggest industry leaders have been able to say that they could recycle 98% of their material. And that's because we don't do source separation anymore, but we can and it is possible. And then you also have the energy savings, the 40% energy savings on top of emissions being lowered for this material because it's not a new material being mined and melted down, releasing new toxins. It's unique in the sense of it's already been melted. So when you melt it again, it doesn't release the same emissions, which is very cool to say. And then the next thing is that the transportation is more efficient. That's specifically to my fleet. We have geared our entire fleet to be a lot more flexible and efficient than other industries and other traditional hauling and recycling. And that's merely because we only deal with glass. So we have smaller trucks that still carry the amount and the loads that we need them to. They can fit into smaller alleyways. They're more gas efficient. So it makes it a lot easier for us to cater to the difficulties of glass. And then, of course, the factor of three. For every pound of glass we're pulling out of single stream, we're saving an additional 3 pounds of other recyclable material to be sent to other processors here in the nation. So where I get into our programs and services of what we offer, this is why we did it. So processing is my core business. We take the glass in. I do accept glass from other haulers who do source separated glass recycling if they have it, but very few of them do. So we started our own glass recycling services and programs to help not only municipalities, but also private industries as well, businesses, to do the same thing because they really wanted to do the right thing. And the first program we launched was called Glass Valet. This is for our private industry, so this is for businesses, your restaurants, your bars, your event centers, apartment complexes. Anyone who has a glass stream, a glass waste stream, is someone that we service and cater to. So we do have resorts, we have ski resorts, we have hotels, we have the airport in this system. We have all sorts of clientele in this system and they are loving it. And the benefits that they're seeing is that it is pretty cost neutral for most of them if they don't save money because we're coming in at a much lower rate. My incentivization, the way I incentivize my clients is that I actually come in helping to cover costs for our services since I am a processor as well. And it really helps to just cover our drivers. And so we help to make it a cost neutral program for them so that they're either paying the same amount of money for the same waste that they're producing or they're saving money because they're pulling so much waste, so much weight out of their waste or single stream. So those are some additional bonuses that they've seen. They also see a cost savings in safety. So this is very similar to how you would look at anything in hospitals with needles, sharp things. Because glass is a risk, when it breaks, most of the time it breaks into shards. And it's not something that they see either within a garbage can, in a recycling can, or maybe they're sweeping it up. When it's very clearly labeled that this is a glass-only can, it reduces the risk of their employees getting cut. It's a really neat thing to see. A lot of them are seeing glass being shattered when they throw it down a chute. When they have glass separated into a bin that's a lot more convenient for people to utilize because it's a small bin, they're not having glass go down chutes and they're not seeing it being shattered as much, which is saving them a lot in safety. And then you see efficiency in operations. And so some of them are seeing some great efficiencies where their busboys or their bartenders are actually not emptying the bins as much. It's probably because they just have an additional bin, but they are very excited about this because their bartenders are helping to service their clients a lot more. Their busboys are focusing on the things they need to a little bit more instead of emptying that trash. And so they're very excited when they see that they can focus on their clientele. And then free training. We do offer free training. I try to train every single client that I have in my programs, no matter what. And so we start every single client off the same. We bring them training materials, we bring them posters. We make it very clear as to what is glass and what is not. Believe it or not, a common misconception is that a ceramic plate is glass. So that is our biggest problem in the industry right now, actually, is teaching people what is ceramic and what is glass. Mm-hmm. So the free training comes in. If they need it, we are there for them. We help them every step of the way. We go through their entire operations and we try to really help them to optimize their operation and make this a success for them as well as for us. And then on top of that, you have additional benefits of pollution reduction on the roads because we have a more efficient fleet. And then you have a reduction in local pollution reduction in local manufacturing as well. And then you also have savings on roads as well because our trucks are not as heavy. So we're not creating as much damage to the roads with the trucks and the systems that we have, which is a pretty neat thing to start looking at and realizing that we can offer to cities and municipalities that are not beating up your roads as much as other trucks might for this same service. The next program that we have is our public glass drop-off stations. So our glass stations are our public option. This is the big program that we have in municipalities. Municipalities typically are paying for these for the public to use, and they are created specifically to go into high traffic areas. So these are not your typical roll-offs. From my research and studying for years in the recycling industry, I studied the world of different recycling infrastructures to see what worked and what did not. And amazing things started coming about. One was that people are not going to travel more than a mile to a mile and a half to get to a drop-off. They're just not. So placing one big roll-off typically is not the best way to reach the public and make them happy. The second thing is that they really don't like big, stinky areas. Go figure. So they would rather go to someplace nice, even though it might be smaller. And of course, they want to see it clean. If they don't see that it's being emptied as often, they don't see that it's being taken care of, they start to get the feeling that it's actually not worth it, that maybe it's not being recycled, maybe the program's just not working. And so we focused very hard on finding convenient ways to get to the public, and these glass stations were the answer. So these are fully enclosed stations. We have two carts within them. They have a flooring, they lock, they have a hydraulic top to them, and they have very clear signage. This is so people know what you can recycle in it and what you cannot, so it automatically creates an education system within it. And we put them in front of very convenient spots. Currently, we have them in front of golf courses, liquor stores, gas stations, parks, schools, grocery stores, you name it, event centers. They are doing very well, and not once have we had a complaint about glass being on the ground, which is a common concern about them. We keep them very clean, we keep them maintained, and we keep them empty. The biggest complaint we have is that we don't have enough of them. So that is something that we are very excited to say we would love to expand this program even further and work with more municipalities on making this an opportunity for the public to access. With that, the cost of them, they do have a one-time placement fee to go through how we get them set up. The placement fee is matched, so we actually do help cover a lot of the costs as well to try to make it affordable for municipalities. We want to see the public have access to these. And then we have operations, very different. This is a unique part of this program, is that we do have sponsors for covering the operations. So unlike any other program that I'm sure you guys have seen where you're paying for the service of the program, I've actually flipped this around and went to the stakeholders of the industry and said, if you guys want this as well, because we all do, why don't you help to sponsor a program for a municipality? If they can pay a placement fee, how about you help to sponsor it? And you can be a sponsor of the program and we'll put you on the station as a thank you. And so far we've gotten very good feedback about that. People have been very excited and we've been expanding the program ever since. We are now not only in Denver, but now we're getting pulled up into the north and far into the mountains. And so they've been doing very well and we've been doubling up in a lot of locations ever since. So we've seen this program launch very successfully in the past year and double very quickly. With that, My proposal to the city of Wheat Ridge is what I've studied of Wheat Ridge is the size, the square mileage of what you guys have in the population. Those come into play into how many stations that you would need or have according to a driving distance radius of 1.5 miles for any public drop-off station or any person driving to a public drop-off stations, which would equal 6 locations. So that would be 3 miles apart from one station to another. So if someone were exactly in the middle, they're really never driving more than 1.5 miles, which is great for them. So I just threw some stars in there to kind of give you an idea of how you would expand it out and what you'd be looking at. That is by no means what has to happen. That is just an example I'm giving you of Wheat Ridge. The second thing is that the tons per month that is estimated to be generated, and this is a calculation done by the EPA. So we actually had worked with them, got a calculation, and that's how we pull the tons per month from the public, only generated by the public. This is not by businesses. But for Wheat Ridge's size and population, you're looking at about 103 tons or 206,000 pounds of glass being produced every single month just in Wheat Ridge alone. So if we were to actually saturate the market, we'd be looking at 6 locations, and in a few years' time, probably close to 24 stations. This is not something to do all of a sudden right now. That's what you would aspire to over the years as it was needed. So you would grow as it was needed, as people were starting to utilize the program and they were to be fully optimized. So the pilot program that I have suggested, if you would like to start a pilot program to test it out, is that we would offer 3 months with 3 stations to test out in a few different places. We would cover the cost of getting it started for 3 months. We would cover the cost of operations to let you guys see how you would like it. Now, if you would want to launch officially, I would suggest having six locations. So you would start with 6 stations. So it was equally spread out through Wheat Ridge for your public to use. And that would cost Wheat Ridge $2,500 as I'm covering. I'm asking for you to help cover 5, and I will throw in a 6th station in there, as I do want to see this happen for Wheat Ridge. I think this would be a very exciting thing. And then we would cover the cost of operations until we were able to get additional sponsors in Wheat Ridge to help us cover the program for operations. And then the recommended expansion would be a yearly review to see if it would need an expansion, but I would suggest adding 6 a year just to be a steady flow. If you were going to get up to 24 stations, then you would be looking at roughly 4 per location as needed. If you weren't needing 6, then you would go with an additional 1, 2, or 3. That's where the review would come in very handy. We do measure all of our stations. So after every quarter, something that I do give all of my municipalities and anybody actually who is in our program is we have systems on our trucks that we have scale systems on all of our trucks, so we know how much every station location is producing. So we can tell you, hey, after 4 months, this one location in particular isn't doing so great, but this particular location over here, we're filling up and we're actually having to come out twice a week. They need a second location. Can we move a station over there? Can we expand to that location? And so we give you that report every quarter, and by the ending of the year, we would be able to give you a full year report of and recommendation of how the program did and what we think would be the next best step.
Thank you, Brittany. Oh, I thought you were done.
There's one more, it's the last part.
Go ahead.
It's the ongoing sustainable program. Just to be clear, the biggest part of making this program sustainable is public outreach. I just want to clarify that is key. So reaching out to the public, getting out to them, and letting them know that the program is out there, just placing the station isn't good enough. So where I do try very hard to create partnerships, what's been the most successful within our programs working with municipalities is when both of us are doing outreaches. So we've had a lot of help finding station hosts, so places to put the actual stations from the cities. And then we go in and place the station and we maintain it and we maintain that contract. That has worked very well. And then the next thing that really does help is press releases, public outreaches, newsletters, utility bills have worked out very well. and having the locations on maps on websites. And then we also push out a lot of information to the public as well through our social media. We do a lot of press releases, news articles, and we release the maps out as well. So that is key to a sustainable program, and that is what I would request of the city of Wheat Ridge if this were to be a program that you would like to move forward with. And that is it.
Now I can say thank you.
Thank you.
Gotta be some questions here. I looked to the right first, so I'm gonna have to go that way. Ms. Turin.
Thank you. Thank you for the presentation. During the pilot program, the three stations you would provide, how would you determine where those are gonna be?
The best way for that would be to work with you guys on that. So any municipal program that we've started, we were very hand in hand with the municipality.
Mm-hmm.
And so a lot of the times they actually gave the station locations to us and we followed through with it to make sure that it was in a good location where it was in the public's eye, it wasn't in a back alleyway, it was easily accessible and easily identified from a street, or you know, it wasn't hidden. Apart from that, that's really a partnership kind of deal, unless that's okay. Something that you would want us to do.
Right. Okay. And in that 3-month time, if we find that one particular station isn't doing so well, do we have the option to relocate that in the 3-month pilot time?
Yes, and that is actually where we would optimize the program the best. So being that there are a few places that we would have recommendations for, golf courses, mm-hmm. blew my mind. I did not think we were going to have any luck at golf courses, and now we have 6 golf courses, and they do the best. I never saw that coming, but I would suggest if there's golf courses, we should probably look at those. And if those were, if that wasn't a location we were already at, then yes, I would definitely say we would want to move it if it wasn't doing well within the 3 months.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Mr. Matthews.
In line with what Councilwoman Adriana was talking about, do you have some sweet spots? I mean, people, places where people congregate and they're sort of headed there anyway, so they tend to bring their glass there. I'm thinking like in front of a Safeway store. I mean, people are going to get stuff, and or the liquor store where they've got glass bottles. I mean, what do you use besides wine bottles, beer bottles, and pickle bottles? I mean, let's face it. But do you have sweet spots that are preferred locations?
That's it, actually. Yes. So the preferred locations are liquor stores and grocery stores. They do very, very well. We actually have a setup where we have a liquor store right next to a grocery store, and we didn't think we would have to put 2 in front of each because they were right next door to each other. That didn't last so long. So all of a sudden we had to double that within a few months because people had wanted it there. So that's a very good sweet spot.
And since those are private locations, do we have a chance to have an agreement like with, for instance, Safeway or one of the King Supers, whatever, where, you know, do we have a mechanism, Patrick, where we could say, okay, we want to put this on your property? And I mean, I'm putting it on municipal right of way, 300 feet from the door probably isn't going to work well.
Yeah.
So do we have any?
Sure, I think that's the next steps, and maybe Brittany could speak to the city is moving forward with 2 bins. We're putting one, I don't know if it's there yet or not, at the rec center. It's an event, we have an event space there where we use a lot of bottles, and so we're going to try one there. Then also at our parks operations shops off of 44th and Field, which will be available for the public. The one at the rec center will be just available for the events, people that rent the center. So those are 2 I believe we're moving forward with. But yes, I think the next step is to find locations on private property. And I think, as you mentioned, I think, the Applejack area, the shopping centers like that would be great locations. Our code does require a special use permit for these to be placed on private property, but Mr. Dahl and I were just speaking of that. We could look at that process and see if we could clean it up to make it easier, or special use process can be administrative. It can be approved by Ken Johnstone, but it's just a special use permit that needs to be filled out.
My point was, if we want to pursue this, I think as a city, we need to be very proactive that way to get these things placed in optimum locations to try and really, I'm not going to say ensure, but try and make sure they're in the best possible placements for success.
Agree.
I've got Ms. Wooden, then I have Ms. Davis.
It says here in the introduction that you are working with cities like Fort Collins and Boulder. Are you working with some Denver municipalities?
We are actually right now. So mm-hmm. we do work with the Denver municipality as well. Mm-hmm. A little differently, not with the stations as much. Mm-hmm. That's been more of a private push throughout Denver. Denver has been really excited about the Glass Valley. So mm-hmm. they are looking to actually move forward with a couple of different programs with us and mm-hmm. try to really push covering, you know, a certain amount of programs within Denver for bars and restaurants to go into our Glass Valley program. Mm-hmm.
But have other municipalities signed up with you, like your proposal for us?
Yes. Okay. Yes. So Fort Collins did, and they are expanding very quickly. Uh-huh. Estes Park has, uh-huh. so has Summit County. So the cities throughout Summit County, we are growing very quickly throughout the cities and the mountain towns. Georgetown as well. Mm-hmm. And then we are looking also down south at Pueblo, Colorado Springs, and Trinidad.
Okay. So I like the idea. I think it's great. And I think it would be so wonderful if Wheat Ridge could be an innovator instead of a laggard in some things. And so I love this idea that our city is looking at it as a whole, and that we might be one of the first ones in the Denver area. So I think that's a great idea. In your presentation, you also talked about the schools, and we've run into this before numerous times, that school property belongs to Jefferson County Schools. It doesn't belong to us. So while we believe it may be a great thing for schools, that's something that would have to go through them. Have you proposed this to the schools?
Yes, okay. I have. So not here in Wheat Ridge particularly. Mm-hmm. We had a few K through 12 schools that we've worked with, but to my knowledge, they are private.
Okay.
So they launched the programs. We went through all of their liabilities and insurances and made sure that we were being safe and that this program was safe for the kids. Mm-hmm. It did take a while. Mm-hmm. So going through all the loops and the things that they needed to make sure that it was safe for the kids and it was good. Was a success in the ending, and where they were looking to only have it for a project for 3 months for school, mm-hmm. they ended up keeping it and still have it a year and a half later.
I think it'd be great for the schools, and if I don't know how we'd work with Jefferson County Schools on that, but I know many schools would be very, very interested in that program. So thank you for your presentation. And my last question was about the end products. What is the majority of your end products? You mentioned four, but is one
what,
a bigger?
You know, this would be an absolutely a great opportunity to have Mr. Dillaman speak.
Yes.
He's plant manager at Rocky Mountain Glass Bottling and quite a customer of yours, I understand.
Yes, yes. We actually send probably 95% of our glass to them.
Yes, it is.
Mayor, thanks for the invitation. I guess one of the things I would like to...
Can you say your name into the tape?
It's Bill Dillaman. I'm the plant manager of Rocky Mountain Bottle over on West 50th, okay? I guess for starters, one of the things I'd like to suggest as you guys consider this option is to come to our plant. I'd like very much to take you through it, through the plant on a tour. I don't know if you've ever been over there.
No.
But I think it would be worthwhile as you process this offer to really understand what we're going to use this glass for. I give you a perspective in terms of end use. Colorado and Brittany talked about this. The single stream isn't working for glass processing. 30% comes back to us at best. The rest is going to landfill. Landfill's attractive because of the low tipping fees in Colorado, and so it's economic to use that for cover. I get it. But we've got a glass plant right here in town. We melt 765 tons of glass a day over there, 365 days a year. We don't shut down, okay? We have a need for both the flint glass, which is the clear glass. We have a furnace that's making that and amber as well. The cool thing about what Brittany is doing in her organization in terms of the dual stream collection is it allows us to sort glass by color instead of commingling it. We don't have systems to color sort in our plant. We do have some processing capability to get some of the trash out and some of the contamination she talked about. Paper, caps, ferrous, non-ferrous metal detection. But it would be a big deal for us, especially here in town, to be able to capture this glass in dual stream and different colors, because we can put it right in the furnace that way. Give you a perspective, I bought 20,000 tons of amber glass, recycled glass from Michigan last year. Brought it in by rail.
20,000.
Transportation is crazy expensive. We got glass here in town, and if we have a way to get it over to the plant, she talked about 103 tons, I think you said a month. So I process 220 tons a day. So that's like, you know, a drop in the bucket for us, but it's a great place to start. And I'm endorsing this because it's a great way to get good, clean cullet without all the trash in it that I'm currently buying from the MRFs. As you guys may know, we had a processing operation open in Broomfield last week, had a grand opening, Momentum Recycling. We are their sole customer, and they are currently, we've received 3,200 tons of glass from them just since they started up in November. And it's clean, and it's sorted by color. So I have a pile of flint, I have a pile of amber, I have a pile of green, and I can take that and mix it and put it in the furnace. So I think, for starters, I'd like to suggest that we set up a tour. Tell me what's a good time for you to do that. And I think that would help in terms of your thought process on, do we do this? I think it's a great start in Wheat Ridge, and why wouldn't we do it? So questions for me?
Pretty interesting.
Thank you.
Just a quick question. Do you have a pickup station there where the general public can come in and drop off glass?
What we do here at our plant, and actually because we're affiliated with Miller Coors over in Golden as well, we have drop off sites around the valley and at our plant. We push our employees to bring their glass from home. We provide them bins for their garage to say, okay, you can put all your other stuff in the waste management bin, but put all your glass in this one. And they put it in the trunk of their car, they bring it to work, and we got instant raw material that's clean, and we're continuing to encourage that. So yeah, we do have sites. We typically have shied away from the public coming in and driving past the plant and dropping their stuff off. That's a security issue for me. But with Clear Intentions programs, where they're going to collect it and bring it to us, like they are today, it's a win-win for us.
One of our counselors has another question.
Yeah.
So I have a question for you based off of what you just said. So you actually give your employees those square bins to put. Yeah. Is that something that perhaps, this at a discount, you could say, hey, Wheat Ridge residents, you can come and get this square bin? Because I know, for instance, I know we heard that presentation today, but I pay waste management or something, recycling.
Sure.
So had I not heard this presentation, I would have no commitment or desire to set up a separate little bucket for my glass. I would just throw it all in. I pay X dollars a month, and I don't really recognize what it might be doing to our landfills and that type of thing. But I'm just wondering if we had some kind of kickoff with that same, especially with you being in our community,
right,
with that same kind of force, say, hey, here's a great, and this is kind of what they do, and you can come to the city hall or come to this place, and for $5, get your little bucket, or, is that something that you would consider?
I would.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, because it starts with awareness. And
yeah.
Be part of the outreach.
We've tried to roll this out, within Miller Coors because of our sustainability goals. we got the zero waste to landfill last month. We are not sending anything now to the landfill out of our plant.
Mr. Pond wants to throw in a question.
Well, I have a comment. First of all, thank you both. Highly support this. I think we've got a number of other things that are going on over the course of the next couple of months as we look at sustainability in general, and perhaps specific things also like waste management and other options. So I think this information is great. I do think that it's an opportunity we should absolutely tour. We should look at other ways to partner, including with clear intentions. And my only thought is not to hesitate necessarily, but to find the right basically synergy between some of the other things that are going on and that we're considering so that we can be successful in this space, because I think we've got a number of other things that we're trying to look at, and I want to make sure that we're putting the right foot forward and being successful in this. But I think this is fantastic. I more than anything, really, this is a win-win in the sense that the facts that you presented are eye-opening and really, really important, I think. And so that's one side of it. And I think the opportunity for us to support a local, a company inside of this and to be leaders in this space is makes it even better. So
a unique opportunity, yeah. You've got a source of glass in the neighborhood, and you've got a glass plant in the neighborhood,
right,
which is very rare, yeah, in any state.
Yeah.
So
absolutely wonderful. Other questions?
I had one question for Brittany.
Sure. For Brittany?
Brittany, I have a question for you. So I've seen in some areas or parking lots and those types of things, you see bins, if it be, Goodwill type of bins. And I think you kind of alluded to this earlier, that they can get pretty full or mismanaged pretty quickly. How do you guys manage that? Because again, you see some that are overflowed, people put a chair by it, or whatever it might be. So how do you manage that and kind of monitor those bins?
And that's a great question. So the first part of that is where you're placing it. We steer clear of placing the stations in any area that would allude to that, so it's not put in the back by other dumpsters, it's not put in alleyways, mm-hmm, it's really put in the front of a store, a school, a golf course, and that automatically really makes people think, because it's different, mm-hmm, as well. So you have this station here that's standing out, and it's right by the door to my grocery store, so people aren't coming up and putting their chairs or their garbage bags right next to it, because it's just not in a place that you would naturally do that. The second thing is that it is a different style as well. So the stations themselves are unique. They're a unique color. They look very different. And people aren't looking at it and thinking, oh, that's a trash can, because that's what I'm used to seeing a trash can look like. So those are two ways that were preventative in that measure. Then if we do have any issues, let's say tagging, we've actually had graffiti, that's the biggest one, or someone running into a station. My drivers are going around every week picking up from these because they are smaller. And so they actually are geared with a tool set if it's a quick fix, and they can just fix it up, touch it up. Or if it is a big problem, then they send a maintenance request to my office, and we send somebody out within, I believe it's the next 2 days, so 42 hours, to fix it and make sure it stays nice, stays looking good. And the last thing that we do is if there is any glass on the ground, my drivers are trained to sweep it up as well. So they're always being maintained because they're in front of very high traffic areas. So we can't have messes anywhere if we want to maintain the kind of host locations that we do have, such as in front of Whole Foods, for example. That's a very big one for us that we don't want to lose and would lose if we had those kinds of situations.
So it sounds like you put them right in, I don't want to say right in front of the doors, but it does, because like the ones I'm thinking of are still in groceries, in front of grocery stores. They're not by dumpsters, but they almost take up like the last parking spot at the end of the grocery store. And we actually had one in Wheat Ridge. Actually, they were two right next to each other. And it was more towards, you know, again, it wasn't by a dumpster, but it kind of created that look after a while. So you're saying that they are actually more in front of storefronts?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Madam Mayor.
Yeah, Mr. Urban.
Thank you. And I appreciate Councilmember Davis's comments, because those are some of my concerns as well relative to not to, as much as I appreciate your presentation and your intentions are very clear as to what you are expecting to do and what you're expecting from us. This, in my mind, is one bin of many that might be located in a particular grocery store, parking lot, or location. And so I guess my question might be for Patrick Goff related to the special use permit. That is a special use permit relative to this specific bin location, or is it for any type of bin and sort of blanket permission for bins of all sorts and sizes to be used, or is it specific to a particular bin and particular vendor?
Yeah, the latter, to any type of a bin. As Councilmember Davis mentioned, you know, a Goodwill bin or a donation bin, they would all require some type of special use permit, yeah.
Sure. And as much as every bin that's out there might have good intentions relative to why we're needing to recycle or to place items in that bin, my concern is that we take a way to work with the individual property owners or whoever, so that we don't end up having five or six different types of bins sort of hodgepodge down the road, so that it turns into a dumping site for all different things. It's not necessarily your bin that's causing the trouble, but it's right. This sort of idea that this is where the bins are, and that's what I want to try to avoid if possible.
Yes, definitely, and so do we.
Councilmember Urban, I might mention that because it's special use permit territory, that's absolutely ripe for imposing conditions. And if, let's say, it's a special use permit in front of XYZ store, it can be for a given number of bins for a given amount of purposes, or a single purpose, particular location. You can dictate really anything, color, size. All those things are, that's the beauty really of a special use permitting process. You can really focus it so that you're not sort of allowing in unintended consequences.
And I guess to that end, relative to the special use permit, then are we asking the individual property owners to make an application to the city for the placement of these under the special use permit process, or how does that logistically work out relative to the private property locations?
So how it's worked out with other municipalities is that typically the municipality helps us to reach out to a host and get someone who's excited about it and who would be interested in being a host of the station. If there are conditional use permits or things like that, the city typically helps in making sure that that's a smooth process. As soon as a host is identified, we actually take over it from there, and we have the contracts with the private hosts and make sure that they understand we will be on their site. If there's any problem, they can call us and let us know. We will be on the site within, you know, 24 to 48 hours, making sure that everything is taken care of accordingly. Here's what to expect from us. This is what we expect from you. And being that the city is involved in this, they don't have a placement fee. And so there are a lot of hosts who actually really appreciate that, because it does increase their sustainability image as well. And really pushes out to the public what they are trying to portray of themselves. So, but to answer your question, the short answer is that typically, unless a station is on city grounds, we hold that contract with that private entity.
And then would you be the applicant for that special use permit, or would the property owner be the applicant for the special use permit? That may not be a question for you, maybe.
Yeah, that's a good question. We have a employee sustainability committee, and Karen's still back there. Karen Banner, our executive assistant, is part of that, and she's really passionate about this, and
and with the mayor have been working on this, and Joyce Manwaring. So the sustainability committee would help, I think, facilitate this process with clear intentions, and we can sit down with Ken Johnstone, the community development department, and Jerry Dahl, if needed, to put a process together that makes sense for both the city and, I think, clear intentions, and to make sure that, I think, addressing some of your concerns, which are concerns too. And
well, and to be clear on my clear intention on this, is that I want to make sure that upon inviting property owners to participate in this, we're not inviting them into a morass of red tape and encouraging them to participate in a obstacle-free process.
I agree.
Okay. Please, Mr. Fitzgerald.
So as I understand it, what's before us tonight is a trial program in which we would place bins on city property at no expense to ourselves. Is that correct? And what you only need a consensus from us tonight. Is that correct? Or do you need?
Well, we've already moved forward with the two bins on city property at the rec center. And honestly, I don't know if we're paying for them or not. Brittany might be able to answer that. Consensus tonight is to move forward with a more of a citywide program. And if you want to, the city to move forward with that, and the funding would also be a consideration of the city council.
Okay, then I would like to ask for a consensus on two things. One is I'd like to direct the city manager to work with our bottling plant to establish a program for public use of their bins, their small handouts, as Councilwoman Davis suggested. And two, that we offer consensus to go ahead with a larger program.
Let's have some discussion on it. Go ahead, Ms. Wooden.
I'm very much in favor of the program, and I think it's a great idea. However, I do think we're going to be talking this weekend about the sustainability project as a larger project for the city that would include more. And I would like to suggest that this topic isn't put aside, but that we just hold on to it and that we work with our future sustainability committee going forward, and that maybe this is something of a bigger project that they would address overall. So very much in favor of it, but really want it to tie into all the other things that we've been talking about for trash and things like that.
Ms. Duran.
No, I was just going to say, we had talked about an environmental committee or sustainability committee, and who is on that committee. I don't even think we've had that discussion yet.
No, we haven't put it.
Okay, so at the retreat, if we could kind of chat about all that and bring it all together. I know there's other entities that probably want to participate or be involved that we want involved. I'd like to do that.
Mr. Bond, you wanted to add something?
Well, let me just clarify that. We do have it on an upcoming study session to discuss the mechanisms and intentions of a sustainability ad hoc committee. So that will be discussed perhaps briefly at the retreat, but more specifically at an upcoming study session in March. Okay, so that's already on our projected agenda, and that's going to happen. And so I agree. There's already been some suggestion or request to pick up a couple of topics that may come up in the retreat, may get forwarded, frankly, to the sustainability committee to look at, such as waste management from as a citywide trash hauling, et cetera, those things. I expect that, again, this is an ad hoc committee, so this is intended to have a specific duration and intent and report back, so this is not forever, and I believe that we should be holding off on this program forever either. I think we should kind of get through our work, make sure that we find, as I stated before, the synergies for some of the other opportunities that we may be facing, and then move forward. So that's the only reason why I would essentially hesitate, at least on the second part of that consensus, because we've got some things that people have asked to talk about and that we've committed in the upcoming month, and this fits in it. And I think if we were to just go forward with this, we're not really allowing some of the other processes to provide the context for this conversation.
basically we've got some of this already going, and with the three bins, I believe, is where we're at right now.
Okay.
Two.
So I will withdraw my request for a consensus on that item. And just ask for a consensus on asking the city manager to work with our glass recycling, or our glass factory, to develop a program for using their small bins, as suggested by.
Okay.
Right.
Just a quick question on that, Patrick. Is there advertising for those two bins? I mean, I know one of the things she said was that, you know, the outreach for it to be successful, there's some type of advertising. So is there any bit of advertising for those two bins? I know, like, the rec center might advertise itself, but I think my worry is that a lot of people, like, if you're at the gym, you have plastic bottles, and will those go in there? If people don't pay attention. But I guess the thing is so it's almost like at the rec center, you'd have to be intentional. You know, it wouldn't be my water bottle. It would be I'm intentionally, you know, dropping it off. So is there?
Yeah, and I don't think the bins have actually arrived yet, and so we haven't placed them. But I think, again, the one in the rec center is going to be mainly for the event center area. So it'll probably be in a specific location. And I don't know if just our staff will pick up the bottles. Yes.
So it's just staff?
We kind of separated it so that Joyce Manwaring moved forward on the part for the rec center, and that's more of an internal. And then I've worked with Brittany and the mayor, and this is more for an outreach to the whole city. So kind of separate.
Okay, so it's not as if we could kind of start our little bucket.
But the one at I think my understanding, the placement at the Parks Operations Building on 44th and Field will be for public use. So as soon as it's placed, we'll put together a communications plan, and maybe it's going in the connections. That's coming out soon. We'll advertise that.
It would seem to me that the baby buckets would be, you wouldn't want to, perhaps when we get into a bigger program, that they would be more appropriate or... I know, but these are all details that we can work with. So I think basically what I'm hearing is there's a lot of people on this council that are very interested in the whole project. Would that be correct? And we're open to whatever we have to do to get it going, both in a small starter package as we're doing right now, and then look at a larger package. It might be part of our full sustainability program.
Yeah, and because of that, my concern is that if we do start having people start collecting bottles, then with the one spot, it could potentially be overwhelmed. And so I would ask that we wait on working out that system until we have a full plan.
Yeah. Everybody okay? Yep. All right. Do you need anything else?
No, my understanding is we'll task the potentially the new sustainability committee to take this on as a project, and that we have that scheduled for March 20th to talk about a potential sustainability committee.
Great, thank you both very much.
Thank you.
Like it or not, you're really going to be hearing from us. Thank you again.
Just as a fun fact, and I can't help myself, a couple of years ago, my wife and I toured a glass blowing plant operation. And they bragged about they were the only manufacturing process they knew of that had zero waste, because anything they broke went back in the bin and went back in the furnace and came back out again.
Thank you both. We will, you want to say something?
Yeah, Madam Mayor, I guess one of the things, if you are interested in touring the factory, just give me some old dates. You should plan on probably 2 hours.
Wow.
I'll work with you, and maybe we can work on some dates, and I'll shoot it out to them and see if we can get a group.
I'm more than happy to do that.
That's great.
All right, thank you.
Fun some crack.
That'll be fun. Thank you, Brittany.
Thank you.
I think we're done. Exactly.